YOUOWEYOUS fam, what's going on? Y'all already know, CJ here. Listen, man, little insider tip. We going to Egypt, all right? And we documenting the whole thing on Patreon. So it's going to be an exclusive vlog only for our Patreon members. You already know, you should be in the Patreon. If you're not, you know you get access to live podcasts, early releases, extra ETA content, e-speeches from all over the world. You also get it commercial free, all right? I know you don't like them commercials, so jump over on the Patreon app, all right? S2S podcast on Patreon. And I'm telling you, this Egypt trip, man, the wives coming, some other friends, it's gonna be amazing. You don't want to miss it. So make sure you sign up for Patreon today, because by the time y'all hear this, we're gonna be in Egypt, going crazy at the pyramids, all right? So lock in with us, S2S Patreon. We'll see y'all there. Peace.
So what happened was, you had a card in your hand. So it was like a credit card feel. So it was a parking pass, like something you scan to get into your apartment building.
Okay.
So he took it, and we were talking about something. He's like, girl, you don't know what I'm talking about. And he pops me on the mouth.
Oh, you shot first.
Put it like this.
And then I like swung at him and hit him.
Oh, hey, okay. Check came out.
But look, okay.
So I don't care what we were talking about. You just okay. Popped me in the mouth.
Hold on.
You ready? Alright.
Let me preface this by the fact that I didn't know she was tight. I thought we was having a funny, friendly.
Well, you are always having a funny, friendly thing with people, and they're not. Everybody doesn't feel the same
way.
But
she was getting like actually tight, but I didn't know that. In my spirit, I was like, thought we was just riding.
But I don't even know what we were talking about. What were we talking about? Do you know?
No, I don't even remember.
So what did you
do? I just remember being like so like appalled that you was smacking me. It wasn't even like a anger type situation.
Seeing Candace smack somebody is crazy. So what happened was you had a card in your hand. So it was like a credit card feel. So it was a parking pass, like something you scan to get into your apartment building.
Okay.
So he took it, and we were talking about something. He's like, girl, you don't know what I'm talking about. And he pops me on the mouth.
Oh, you shot first.
Put it like this.
Yes. And then I like swung at him and hit him.
Oh, hey, okay. Check came out.
But look, okay.
So I don't care what we were talking about. You just popped me in the mouth.
Hold on. But now listen. She's saying I popped her in the mouth.
Yes, you did.
That sounds like.
Oh, you going to take it and you're just going to go like this?
If I shave my head, I'll take my hat off. We're dry. First of all, it's pitch dark in the car.
Yeah.
I'm driving. I never even looked at her. I was like, girl, be quiet. And I had the car right here. It might have grazed the side of her cheek.
That's how it starts.
Exactly. But look, I'm talking about, imagine me having a card in my hand. I'm driving down the highway or something. And we're like halfway
he's
joking.
He's definitely driving.
Mind you, I'm not going to take my thing. And then how hard can I even pop you with a credit card? On this? Exactly. It wasn't nothing like that.
The idea of it.
Because, hey, Camille, and I thought we were joking.
Disrespect.
I thought we were playing. I thought it was like, you shut up.
You had to think
this
he was playing.
Year
he
one. Went,
bruh,
this is year one.
This dude about tooth, bruh.
I am still in my
so
own way.
So she was turned up, and
I'm
I didn't
still
know.
From
she
this
took it
personal.
Bruh.
She took the plan.
Anybody who knows me, I've never even raised my voice at her. Like, I'm really just about to be like, shut up, pow, and pop you in your face. Like, that would never even cross my mind. But I had a card, and I thought we were playing, so I was like, and whatever, she was more turned up than me.
Yeah.
And she was like, and I was like, so that's how you know I was nowhere near tight, because I didn't even respond like cussing or anything. I was just like, what are you doing? And she was like, I don't know.
Anyway,
it was over. But we learned a couple things we learned from that.
Yeah.
Is we learned never to try to have conversations when you're angry. Like, that's not the, because, so when we got home, she was angry or whatever, and I was kind of like, well, why the hell you hit me? But, like, you can't solve it in the middle of anger. And here's the problem with most married couples. You don't, like, especially most married couples who we counsel and that end up beefing and stuff like that. What happens is they don't ever talk about their marriage until something's wrong, right? So, like, in the heat of that moment, however mad she was, and I got mad because she hit me, and we get back home, and we trying to fix whatever that is in the moment right there, it's never going to happen. I could be like, yo, the grass is green. And she'd be like, no, it's not, it's blue. She could be like, yo, the sky's blue. And I'm like, no, it's not, it's green, because you're trying to win an argument, right? Like, so when you think about having a argument or whatever, the goal of an argument or a debate is to win. So now we're on opposite teams. But what happens is, we try to help our married friends with this. We say, hey, if there's a real issue, hey, we're not spending enough time together, you're not active enough with the kids. If there's something that's going wrong, what they'll do, what most of y'all do, is you wait till it bubbles all the way up, and then you have a big argument in the kitchen, and you go, you don't even spend enough time with the kids, and we ain't there having sex enough, and you ain't, and you're just trying to win an argument. So everything falls on deaf ears. So what we learn to do is have our check-ins, and here goes the thing. Most people are unwilling to do this because when it's smooth sailing and it's comfortable, I don't want to bring up no issue then. I'm not trying to rock the boat right now. Right? Like, we finally on one accord. We ain't arguing. We ain't yelling. We ain't doing none of that. I can finally say me and my wife is straight. You want me to bring up the fact I don't feel like we having enough sex or something right now? And it's like, yeah, that's actually the time to bring it up, because the person is going to be more receptive because it's not falling in an emotional state. But most people can't do that. So one thing we really learned early on was, okay, cool. It's not finna happen tonight. We ain't got to beef out, but this conversation, we could have it, you know, after we sleep it off and we just chill, right? For us, being on one accord, we talk about decisions. We work them out. We talk them through. We go to God about it, whether it be for the kids, whether it be, you know, for anything else. We really lock in and have those conversations. You look at most people who, again, we're talking about bliss now. Like, we wake up and, like, bliss, like, for real, like, texting each other, like, love you, you know, everything, every day. So in order to do that, and I'm just thinking, like, y'all, first of all, we surround ourselves with couples who have that type of energy, which is why having Marl and Camille in our lives has been such a blessing, because it's like, yo, here go people who, like, you can go and be your 100% self with on vacation or, you know, wherever else. And we have several couples, you know, in our circle who you can do that with. It's not a surprise, right? We tend to surround ourselves with people like us. But having that example of, yo, how do you not fall victim to what everybody else does, right? You see people, and after 15 years, they like, man, and I could just speak for the people in my life. When I was growing up, they'd be like, oh, you getting married? Why are you getting married? What time's the funeral? It was always like a negative. You know, that was always like a negative thing to, like, oh, the old ball and chain. Like, all the stuff that you hear that's supposed to be a joke, but you know it got some truth to it. You know what I'm saying? And I was always like, man, this is a decision I'm making to marry this person. Like, nobody got a gun to my head making me marry her. So, like, why not be in the most blissful position we could possibly be in? I want to go now to how the lack of stress, and this is what we kind of been, you know, when I initially thought of having y'all on the pod, was talking about the work thing, and Marl touched on it briefly, but y'all know our stories, and y'all let y'all share y'all's. Marl and Camille, you know, stopped working very early, and Candace worked, you know, into, I told her she was going to retire at 30, but she worked at 31. But that was her and God and E on 30. The 1 year that she worked extra was her, the Lord, and E working something out, which they got worked out, thank God. But I was ready for her to retire at 30. But I want to talk about that because there's been a lot of feedback. Shout out to Mr. Johnson, who got the podcast turned up for a few weeks. There's been a lot of feedback from men saying, like, yo, a woman ain't supposed to carry her load, or, you know, or maybe even, I haven't heard much feedback from the women. Maybe they're okay with it, whatever. Or just like, I'm a breadwinner too, and I'm independent, and I can go make money too. And which we never said you shouldn't. We were talking specifically to the stressors of having a job to report to every day with all the other things that go on in our lives and in our routines and things like that. Let's start with Camille, I guess, because you've been, you know what I'm saying?
Veteran.
She's been retired the longest.
She's my mentor. She's my mentor in retirement.
Yeah. I mean, no, seriously, talk about that, because what would you say to, because you didn't want to keep a job. Like, that was something that you expressed to your husband. Yeah. Like, I don't want to get up and go. I want to be here for you and be able to do that. What did that conversation feel like? How has that worked throughout your lives now? And how do you think maybe it would be different if you were, I don't even know what y'all, I can't even imagine you getting up going to work every day just because you have so much either. That you do for the family outside of that. Not because you don't do nothing, because you do so much to keep the family afloat outside of that. Like, what was that process like?
Well, I will first want to start with like what Candace said, whatever works in your household, then go with that.
Yeah.
If it works for you to go to work.
Whatever works.
Yeah.
Keyword works though.
Right. Well, whatever works for you.
Yeah.
Whatever works for you in your household. Then I think that's what you should do. As a kid, I never thought about like, oh, I don't want to work. I mean, I had aspirations of certain jobs. Of course, I went to college, graduated.
At 19?
Started working, enjoyed my job. Then I had to go to a different job that I hated. And I didn't do much of anything, and I just really hated it. And then when we got married, Jamal asked me, you know, like, well, what do you want to do? Or what can I do for you?
Paint a picture. Where was we at? When from the point we got married?
We were on our honeymoon.
Uh-huh. Yep.
And
where did y'all go for your honeymoon?
We were on our first cruise ever.
Yep.
First cruise ever.
Mm. Yep. So we did.
Come on, Royal Caribbean on the first one. Y'all ain't go Carnival. We were the youngest ones.
We were babies.
We were 22, sitting around with all these middle-aged people.
Mall stretched 36,000 like Jesus with a loaf of bread. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about. He was making that 36 work, Jack.
I fed the multitudes. That 36
was going to work.
And so I told him I didn't want to work there anymore. And I don't think it was that I just didn't want to work. I just didn't want to work there. And so at that point, that's where my mindset was. And so then he was like, you don't have to. Soon as you get back home, you can give them a call and let them know. I said, well, I already left my computer at my desk. So there's no need. I'm like, I don't know if I just didn't have any intentions. I didn't know if he was going to say that while we were there. But that's just kind of how that worked out. And then right before we got married, I took the real estate, the licensing test. And so I was like, okay, well, you know, he's in real estate then.
And she didn't want to be a real estate agent. I think she just saw me doing it and you wanted to support.
Yeah, so it was like, oh, you know, this commission that we're paying somebody else.
Yep.
Shout out to April.
You know what I'm saying?
But I'm like, oh, we can just keep that in the house. And so I went and I took the test. Did I take it twice?
You did.
Yeah, because I didn't get it the first time. So I took it twice. And then after that, I kind of started working with April. And not really working. Not really. Because I think the only properties I sold was to Jamal.
Right.
I'm going to need that money, player.
Yeah, exactly.
And so, Yaya.
This is our money. You realize.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we decided, you know, we started a family, and so then, like, even when I was pregnant, like, Jamal was still just out, you know, doing what he needed to do, and I was just kind of sitting around, didn't have a whole lot to do, so I would go and substitute teach every now and then up the street. I did do that for a little while. Then it was like, oh no, this is stressing me and my baby out. I'm out. But it was one of those things like, oh, you can go in when you want to. They'll call you. No, thank you, that kind of thing. But it wasn't something that I had to do. I can't see myself now, or even while we were having kids, because even at one point I used to keep my nephew. I used to keep Matthew. Mm-hmm. And at that time we had Ayana. It wasn't a daycare. We weren't going to put him in daycare. I just didn't see that. And our parents were still working. So it wasn't about, you know, oh, you can go drop him off at the grandparents. It wasn't that. It was just us. And I was okay with that. I wanted that. So what was your exact question?
No, that's good. And I'm just trying to figure out how that played into you being available for, because if y'all think about it, it's setting up, right? Because you talk about how hard charged Jamal is. He got a million things going on. He's buying properties. He's a police officer. Like, you got to think during this time, Camille is talking. Y'all got to remember, Jamal is literally still working as a Chicago police officer on the streets. So this is not like he has a bunch of free time and he's doing all of that. Then he's doing the properties. Then y'all start the daycare. And that was, so would you consider that work for you? Or, I mean, because you were working. Even when we first hooked up, you would still be at the daycare and doing stuff?
In the very beginning, it was work, but it was a different kind of work. It was our baby.
It's the kind of work where she signed her own. So literally, her check, she signs her own check on the front. Then it's a different feeling. On the back. It's a different feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah, but in the beginning, we were both working. Like, even because I think you were injured or something.
Yeah, that's what I told my ACLs.
We first opened the daycare. And so Jemal was in there making breakfast. He was in there. We were doing everything we had to do. We had to do everything together. And that goes back to that teamwork. Every business that has ever been started, both of us have had our hand in it at some point together. Mm-hmm. Even if at this point, like, I'm all hands off on the security company. But in the very beginning, we were doing interviews. We were hiring people. Right. We were doing all that in the beginning. So that's, like I said, that's something I think we do well. We are a great team. We work well together.
This is a major hypothetical. But how do you think things would be different if you had just been working throughout? Just your own, nothing to do with the family, just working. Let's say you just climbed the corporate ladder at Enterprise and worked there for 20 years.
It would be extremely stressful. I don't know where our children would be. I don't even know if we would have the amount of children that we would have. I don't even know if some of our friends would have some of the children that they have, because they were able to bring their kids to the daycare and not even have to pay for childcare. And childcare is extremely expensive these
days. We would have been missing out on millions of dollars. Daycare have been around for about 17 years.
You know,
$1 million every year.
I don't even want to know what that's like, because at the end of the day, I was able to take my children to school. We were able to pick our children up. We went to every graduation, every play. I was a room mom, passing out snacks, tennis games, baseball with Vontrell, his football games. We were able to be present in all of our kids' lives. Yeah. And it would have been impossible. I don't know. I think that it would be impossible, but there's parents that's doing it some kind of way.
What's happening, S2S fam? Listen, as a part of your success journey, you've got to ensure that your body is operating at its peak. And that's where Organifi comes into play, your ultimate ally in the quest for optimum health. Think about it. How often do you find yourselves on the go, struggling to maintain a healthy lifestyle? Organifi has cracked the code with their lineup of superfood blends, making it a breeze to get the nutrients your body craves. And guess what? They've got an array of supplements designed to cater to your unique needs. From peak power that helps with mental focus, to protein shakes that help build your muscle, and everything in between. Y'all know how often we travel, right? And consistency, especially in your diet, is really, really tough. But no more, guys. The convenience of the superfood blends is a game changer. No more sacrificing nutrition for a hectic schedule. Organifi has you covered. Here's the exciting part. When you visit Organifi.com/success, you not only gain access to their fantastic range of supplements, but also snag an exclusive 20% off your order. Yes, 20% off just for being a part of the Secrets to Success community. Whether it's their green juice, red juice, gold, Organifi has something to elevate every aspect of your well-being. So S2S enthusiasts, take charge of your health journey. Head to Organifi.com/success now and enjoy 20% off your order. That's Organifi.com/success.
Shout out to them.
Yeah, and shout out to them for sure. And shout out to them who, again, we're trying to paint a picture for y'all. So go back to the earlier statistic. Talk about half of the marriages ending in divorce. And then we said maybe even half or probably a little bit more than that, not being in bliss.
Right.
And then Maul said something that was so deep that stuck with me when, you know, a few pods back, for those of y'all who heard it, when he was like, it's not when his back was hurt and Gersh was finding the pain through his hamstring. And he was like, it's not your back that's messed up. It's connected to your back. Mm-hmm. And people think their marriage is messed up. And it's not your marriage. It's connected to your marriage. But what's really messed up is, like, really, like, for those of y'all, you're not happy in your marriage, like, literally find it. It may be I'm stressed out at work.
Yeah.
And I, like I said, and we'll get to our story in a minute, because I told it on the pod, you know, but she can tell it from her version. But, you know, her problem wasn't with me necessarily. She wasn't like, oh, our marriage sucks. Our marriage was great. She had work stress and time commitment stress, right? And so for those of you out there, what we're talking about, and if you're taking it and going, man, okay, cool, what Camille is saying is she was able to get rid of that stress, and now they were able to, could they have still done it? God willing, but we don't know. And I bet if you look at a lot of people who are stressed, a lot of that comes from you got two people, like you said, working completely separate lives. If one of them, God forbid, or both, right? Let's say you both have a job that's stressful and you can't stand. It's hard to come home to bliss.
Yep.
When you got, think about it. You go to work 8 hours a day. If you live in Atlanta like we do, you got an hour commute there and an hour back. That's 10 hours a day. It's only 24 hours a day. You should sleep for 8. Now you got how much time? You spend more time there than you do with me. Yep. So imagine when she was, and that was me just being, I think I took so long trying to get us to where we were financially. I took so long, like y'all got to understand, when I tell you Candace held it down, when I say, he be trying to cap. When I say no money, I'm talking about we graduate college and go on the road and I'm making zero, not $1,500 a month that I was making as a grad assistant. No, I'm talking about zero for years. So when we finally locked in and the money started coming and E was number one in the world and we started to get it, I did get very wrapped up in like, it's on now. And I didn't even think about, and I thought about her working at GE, but you know, my wife is strong. She's from Detroit. She didn't really, you know, start, in the end, she started to crack. But at the beginning, she was just like, yo, I'm just going to do what I got to do. But I never even thought like, yo, you could be messing up your marriage if you don't hurry up and get her out of there, you know? And I was just so driven and focused because it had took us so long to finally get there that when I got there, I was like, yo, go, go, go. And so here I am flying around the world with E, doing speeches, kissing babies, shaking hands, and, you know, running for president. Life is fantastic. I'm finally, and I looked at her and she was kind of like, hey, I'm still over here doing this. And so I probably should have been a little bit more forceful early on. But then once I started to see the signs from you, I saw a few cracks. And I was like, hold up. You know what I'm saying? I told the story of you crying at our housewarming party, you know, and you being upstairs, like I couldn't find her for like an hour. She was upstairs in the master bedroom. Am I telling the truth?
Yeah, this is true.
Crying over her laptop with tears falling onto the keyboard. And that was when I was like, okay, you're done. Like, I don't know, 2 week notice, I don't know how this works. You are done. But it took to get there, but I'll let you go ahead. You can.
You said
okay.
A lot.
So okay, like, so let me tell you, okay, so let me say this. How was, even though you were doing very well at GE, shout out to my wife, was killing it and climbing the corporate ladder, raises, bonuses, positions out of the country. We went to Paris for months. We were supposed to go to Beijing. I shut that down because I was like, I heard they ain't got that type of internet in China. I can't go because things were starting to pick up for us. But like, how did that, like, because people don't know. Well, like, they be laughing at me now because I go up to the school and they be like, hey, who is this a little bit? You know what I'm saying? But people don't know. When the kids was in daycare, I was up there every day. I picked up, dropped off. I knew all the parents. I knew everybody. And she would come up there and they'd be like, ma'am, who's your child?
Yeah.
And she would be like, oh, what class are they? She would call me like, hey, I think, you know, she like, they in this class. But that was affecting you.
Yeah. I mean, I think it goes back to what we said. You got to figure out what works for your household. So for us, it was just like, hey, I'm the worker. So when you talk about what I was doing, I was getting up at like 6 o'clock at least. I was probably waking up at 5:30 just to get out of my house by 6:15 to beat the Atlanta traffic to get into the office. Mm-hmm. And then even while I'm on the way to work, half my team is in Switzerland. So I'm on the phone calls immediately when I get in my car, like, oh, this meeting, this update, this submission, whatever. So then, and I wouldn't be getting home until like 7 o'clock at night. Like, seriously. So kids CJ,
bedtime is
so
eight
CJ
o'clock.
Literally was doing wake up, like dinner, pick up, drop off at school. He was doing it all. And he wasn't a stay-at-home dad. He was still working, I guess.
Whatever, oh, for sure.
Whatever it is you guys do, you guys are doing that.
No, for sure.
And so it was but so
you,
for
okay,
me.
Okay, so I want you to hear that.
Yeah. Yeah, leave CJ
at,
was doing.
Leave at 5:36.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come home at 7.
Yeah. And then I would be putting my kids down for bed, get and then I would get back on my laptop after I.
So when I said 80 hours, people were looking at me like I was crazy. It might have been 70.
Yeah.
So everybody who said I was exaggerating, now she got a meeting with China because they on a different time schedule. And then when she not working, she got emails coming in. She got all kind of stuff. And I just remember being like, okay, like this is. I guess we kind of got used to it because when we were on program,
right?
She was working.
I didn't even count hours how I worked. I just count how many hours I slept because if I wasn't sleeping, I was working. Oh. So that's the math.
But here go the thing, because I'm not a needy guy. Like from a he knows that I'm very low.
Yeah, he's very
right?
low maintenance. A few as little a things,
boom, my sounder ain't working.
It ain't like you need your suitcase. It ain't like you need your luggage pack.
I feel like Jemal knows a few things.
It ain't like
he needs flosses.
I need a flosses.
Goodie powder so he can
get a goodie powder in case I got a headache. What else?
Maybe some mints or something like that.
Yeah, some mints because I be speaking a lot out in public.
So we joke.
But there's not a lot of things. And then my sounder. You know what I mean? All right. For those of y'all been there. That's it. But I'm saying, I'm not like
it's still not, your sounder's not on right now?
No, that's not what he's talking about.
Okay. So,
no, you know what I'm talking about.
Right, exactly.
How you miss that?
So look. But I'm saying, I know some dudes, and shout out to y'all, whatever, you like, oh, I need to, you know, you got to be ironing my clothes or washing, like making me something to eat. I just never, I tell you what, when she finally retired and she got out of that quick,
I did,
it was fine.
And I'm so thankful I did.
I'm talking about remember the conversation? Did I record any of that?
I'm sure y'all had.
In a nightclub.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I remember that.
Oh, the scripture
we was throwing scriptures. Oh.
But look.
See, Jemal cussed me out with scriptures.
He did.
Oh, we was going in.
And I appreciate that assist because Maul definitely helped me get you to retirement. But I remember it was like the first day. Let's say her last day was a Friday. It was Monday. And I was on the phone doing something. And she was like, would you like breakfast? And I was like, what? I was so confused. She would be like, yeah, I'm going to make you breakfast. And I was like, I wanted to say no. Because I was like, I don't, first of all, like, she knows I'm very, y'all know I'm how I eat. And you know, my schedule is very like finicky day to day in terms of like what I'm on or whatever. It's the same, but it's, you know, sometimes I might, if I'm working, I'll be like, I'll do it after that. If I don't get a chance to work out, whatever. But you were like, yeah, you want me to cook you breakfast? And you did for like...
I did for a few months.
Two, three months. You know what I'm saying? And so I'll say this. So then getting to the point where you realized this is too much. And how did you feel when you... I mean, I don't really never heard you talk about... How did you feel when you would get home and only have an hour with the kids? And I think Avery kind of took it up another notch.
No, so I think at the end of the day, it was just a situation, how I explained it was like, we have this beautiful life that I'm not enjoying. Like, we have the house, we have the car, we have the kids, we travel. But and I began to sound like a broken record. Like, everywhere we went, I had my laptop. We going out to dinner with friends, I got my laptop. Mm. We going on vacation, I got my laptop. And it was just like, and I would be like, oh, I just, one last email, one last, let me update this thing. And I was like, Candace, you literally sound like a broken record. Like, we got, something has to change. So I feel like for me, that was the biggest piece was the way that we were going and your career wasn't slowing down. And I think the big aha was that what I was doing was now, my career was now getting in the way of what we were, what the overall vision was. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? And I wasn't passionate about that career. Yeah. I think that to me was the conflict. It wasn't like, oh, this is something that I love, that I'm passionate about. This was, in my mind, this was always a means to an end. So, but the question, the weird part came when, okay, how far is the end? So even when we bought our house, I said, I don't want this house if it means I still have to go to GE. Like, I literally told you that. And I was like, so if we're good financially, what you got going on, your plans, if we're good there, cool. But I don't want to make any moves that requires me to be working 80 hours a week. So I think that was, you know, something that kind of helped us, is defining when was the transition, because I never imagined being a stay-at-home mom or anything like that, or at-home wife, whatever.
You're still not.
I'm still not. But that just wasn't ever my vision for me. And I think Josh made it really practical. Shout out to Josh. He said, happy people have options when it comes down to it. So you have the option to do whatever you want to do, whether you want to work, whether you don't want to work, you have the option. So I think that's where the freedom and joy comes in. Say, I have the option. If I decide I want to work, I can work. If I decide I don't want to work, I don't have to work. It's the option.
Did you ever feel any pressure from me to leave your job outside of you being stressed about it?
No. You were 100% supportive. And I think...
Right, I want fellas to hear that, because, I think there was that, like, or maybe even from the pods before, when you don't have a woman's perspective, and that's why I'm glad y'all get to speak for yourself. It wasn't like I was like, you need to be home doing X, Y, Z.
Never.
Again, she'll tell you, my husband is the most low maintenance. Like, she just says, about four things I need. But, like, I've never been the one to, like... You need to have dinner ready. Like, and a quiet is kept. Like I said, I ain't gonna say she work as much now, but y'all know Candace kind of runs the church. You still work a full 40 hours
right
a week for sure.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, not 80, praise God, but 40. But it's a non-stressful 40. And I've never put pressure on you to be like, you need to stop doing so much work with the church and you need to focus.
And that's what
on.
She enjoys.
Too. Absolutely.
Right. Yeah.
And
so that's what,
and that
that's
was my point
part.
Is that. Yeah. Shout out to Camille. She just said it. What works for you in your household?
Yeah.
What's happening in your household is something's not working.
Yeah.
It don't matter. If she a doctor and you a lawyer and doggone it, y'all both working 60 hours a week and y'all got bliss when y'all come home, this is not for you.
Yes.
We are talking to those of you who are struggling and you think your marriage is the problem. Your marriage is not the problem. Your marriage is connected to a problem that you haven't fixed.
Right. Yeah.
And so for us, it started to become a problem because you got to think. Also, my wife is a company man. Like, she not...
Company man.
Not, yeah, 100%. You know not a company mean. Woman. A company man. I'm talking about, like, it's no such thing as, like, oh, I'll get to it next week. Like, she is, like, this is... I've signed up for this. She reporting for duty every day. Like, it's the military. Straight up. So I'd be like, hey, don't send that. Like, so she's not going to chill. You know, it might have been some people who's strong enough to tell their boss, like, hey, I'm not doing that. And I used to be looking like, yo, how they running you ragged like this? Like, that's not even healthy for somebody to be working this kind of hours. And then they throwing you. I said, boo. I said, matter of fact, if I, your little $160,000 or whatever they pay, I'm like, they really only paying you about $5 an hour. You know what I'm saying? Like, if because you're looking at the hours. Like, everybody's saying, oh, this is how much you make. Yeah, but how much you working was crazy. And so we just went through a lot, man. And, you know, for me, like, there was a time when she was working and we traveling. I told the story, but, like, her coworkers would be looking at me like, you just ride around the country with your wife? Like, imagine we in Houston and I'm just, they like, oh, he's just at the house while you working all day? Like, it was just weird, right? Like, most of the most of the married couples who were on program, it was the man working and the wives were staying back.
Yeah.
And they was having, like, Starbucks days and, like, all kinds of, like...
The wives would get together, yeah. And then they would invite
you. Did you go see?
Yeah, it's latte.
Got a double right, shot espresso. Yeah.
Yes.
Mocha latte.
Right.
So, again, when you talk about my drive to be like, yo, this was all a part of it. You know, again, my mom and dad lending us a couple of dollars here and there is like, man, I'm the weak link right now. You know what I'm saying? Like, but... I say this, to my point, and when I asked her about her job, never one time did she make me feel like, and I want to get to that too, did she make me feel like, I promise you, this is a true statement. Y'all would not know nobody right now, if one time my wife was like, hey, you don't think you should just go get a job right quick? I'm talking about that's how close I was to the edge just in terms of not my faith in what me and E were building, but in my commitment to my wife and watching her work like that and not being able to live the way that I thought she should live, if she would have been like, all right, babe, it's been 3 years. Y'all ain't really hitting on nothing. It's time. I would have dropped everything right there. I might have still been like, I get with you on the weekends or something. I would have went and got a job right then and there, paying the bill. I mean, I had a master's degree, and I was far capable of doing whatever, you know, I had job offers out of college. Like, I could have gone and made money, but you never, ever made me feel like that. Matter of fact, if she sensed I was getting frustrated, she would push me even harder to be like, nah, y'all got this. Y'all about to be this, y'all about to be that. And I'm talking about this is when nobody heard of us, when nobody knew who E was. She would be like, yo, I believe. And that's the God's honest truth. Had you at one moment lost faith and been like, hey, bruh, it's been real, but now's the time, all of this wouldn't even happen. So I thank you for that. Because when I say you're the reason that we're here, it's 1,000,000%. And you made big time sacrifices. Like I said, imagine. And then it's like, I don't even do the kind of work where I'm like out the crib. So it's like, I might be sitting around in my drawers, talking to E on the phone, answering emails. There wasn't no FaceTime back then.
Talk about that.
I'm just saying,
you talking to E in your drawers. Last episode, you talked about going to buy him some drawers.
He
was in his drawer.
And y'all was FaceTiming each other from the man section.
When you work from home, you live how you want to live. But we would talk every day. But like I said, you got to think. I'm trying to paint a picture. I didn't have a kind of job where you out the house. So it's
the work. I got to add a little bit to this. Because one day I opened up his laptop and I was like, I was taken aback because I'm like, you haven't opened this laptop in 6 months.
Oh, I don't use the laptop, no.
So I'm working crazy. I'm like, oh, I got to do whatever personal thing on his laptop. So I'm like, okay, let me go in here and pay a bill. And I look, I'm like, I don't know if you were writing something or something was on there. I'm like, he literally hasn't opened his laptop in 6 months. And then I went to him. I was like, okay, babe, I'm never kind of questioning what you got going on, but I need you to break down your schedule for me. Like, I need to understand what's happening when I'm not here.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, I'll go to, I wake up, whatever time, I feel like I need to get up. And then he's like, yeah, I got to go to the gym. That's very important. Hit the gym first. And he's like, I get back home about noon. He's like, and I got to read my Spartan articles. I got to check out what's going on with football. Mm. And he's like, and I'll probably do a little work. And then by 3 o'clock, I shut it down. And I'm like, are you kidding me?
Okay, that was a nice embellishment for sure.
No, that was great. This was fast.
Yeah, no,
I ever going to the gym and been out by noon? I went to the gym at 7 o'clock every single morning.
You weren't getting up that early.
Cap.
Yeah, so anyway,
it
was the contrast.
Huh? Yeah, no. The contrast for sure. But I wasn't working 80 hours a week. But what you and Didi failed to understand is that if I'm on the phone with E, we're working, which you don't consider work. So there wasn't physically anything for me to do at the moment other than strategize, be on the phone with Carl and E, talk through stuff, checking emails, watching our YouTube. Like, it just didn't look the way you thought it should look. So that it didn't, again, I was trying to give her credit, but now she didn't took it too far now. You know what I'm saying? Like, I wasn't doing nothing. Well, trust me. I told you and Didi, we didn't make it to number one in the world with me chilling. That's definitely not what happened, why y'all thought we was chilling. Mm-hmm. We definitely did something correct. But either way, see, now I can go back to thanking you. Why you trying to play me like we just... I woke up and we was number one in the world. It was crazy.
No, I just thought it was just in terms of the contract.
No, I didn't have the type of schedule had where it was like
crazy.
I open my laptop and I work on a spreadsheet for 10 hours straight. No, I was on the phone with E, on the phone with Carl, answering a couple emails, checking our YouTube.
Mickey Mouse Club.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, I'm getting shot at.
Different world.
Yeah. It definitely wasn't that either.
Different world.
So... when you finally did retire.
Transition out. Yeah.
Yes. How did that change our situation?
I think it was everything just got clear, if that makes sense. I wasn't as distracted. I was able to lock in and just fully enjoy the life, if that makes sense. You wire yourself for go, 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 and that becomes your normal. So the scary part about it is we're running ourselves into the ground and we don't even know it because it's just our normal. So I think for me, it's like I didn't even know. Like, it just becomes who you are. You know, it becomes a pattern. So I think, but the fact that I have options now, I can kind of make my own schedule, do what I want to do because of what the place you've been able to put our family in, I just enjoy it. I'm able to enjoy life. And it was funny when I was leaving GE, everybody was like, what are you doing? Obviously, you're going to another company. How much are they paying you? We can match it. And I was like, I'm not going anywhere. They're like, you sure? Like, you can tell us. Like,
yeah, you remember friends? That lazy husband
right,
I had?
They were right. They were just like.
Buy this whole company right now.
Oh, this is so bad. I don't want to get into it, but so we were just, I was able to just enjoy myself, enjoy all of this life that God is able to bless us with. So I think that's the biggest thing. And to Camille's point, as she's talking about what her life looked, being room mom, doing all this stuff at the school, I'm like,
I'm earth parent,
you know, just be able to show up. But it's like, it's weird. Like, and I don't know if it's just our culture is there's not a lot of Black stay-at-home moms. You know what I'm saying? In my kid's school, I might be still the only one. You know, most of the stay-at-home moms are with, predominantly white women.
You can say white on the podcast.
Yeah, they're white. And that are at home. So I don't even, this life that we're living isn't a normal life.
That's just a fact. You listen to what she's saying. That's just a fact. Most of the moms who are able to just go in and out all day, every day.
Or it's moms who don't have an option. So it might be moms who stay at home, but they don't have the option to go to work because they can't afford to go to work because it's more expensive for childcare.
Wow.
So it's to me, it all comes down to options. You know, that's what, like, whether you want to go to work, if you want to go to work, you can go to work.
I don't know how many people at our kids' school got that issue, but
I'm not saying in our school. I'm just saying in general, for the women that I know who didn't work, it was like that. Not, I'm free. I can make my own schedule. I can do what I want. I can go to work or not go to work, work part-time, do whatever. We didn't have that option. I mean, most of all, I'm just thankful. I'm happy, and I'm just enjoying our life.
And do you feel any type of way about, I think there's some women who would be like, I gotta make my own money in case something fall through. And I'm just trying to tell you what we saw on the comments. There was,
that's real.
There was some women who like, hey, I ain't about to be giving up my whole life, and then you end up leaving me for some 22-year-old, and I'm out here bogus, and I don't got no money, and I ain't had no career in the world. I'm just telling you what they're saying. I'm saying, has that ever crossed y'all mind? Go ahead, Camille. Because my wife looks befuddled. Right. My wife looked like she ain't even remotely.
No, that didn't cross. Did that cross my mind? I don't know. I think we built our life together. Everything is together.
That part.
So God forbid one of us decides that we don't want to listen to the Holy Spirit and we want to do it the hard way, then I think either one of us would be okay if you're talking about financially, but that's not what this is about. Like I said, I hate divorce.
For some people, it is about finances, though. You know what I'm saying? Like we have friends that are divorced. Y'all have friends that are divorced. We have there's divorce in the air, and finances tends to be another thing that's connected to the divorce, right?
That would be the least of our concerns. My main issue.
And I don't mean now. I mean even back then. Because you stopped working early, so you could. That was a lot of trust in.
Well, 36,000 ain't a lot to split.
Well, I mean,
$36,000.
The way you was working at 36,
that ain't a lot to split.
Yeah, the way you were working at 36.
After Uncle Sam took his cut, it might have been like 28.
No, I'm saying, but even early on, that's a lot of faith for you to put in him to be like, all right, I'm done. And
that's true. But then if something happened, I could just go back and get a job. It wasn't like I wasn't qualified to work or I was unable to work. So, I mean, if something happened, then you just go back to work.
Well, I mean,
I
think some women may feel like, look where Candace was in her career. You don't get to go start exactly where you left off in a corporate type situation. She was rising the ladder, doing her thing. Like, again, obviously, she's super sharp and so are you. You go back and get a job. But a lot of women look at, hey, I'm climbing the career ranks. You go back after 10 years and you're like, all right, I'm ready to go to work now. Put me in the... A lot has changed, I'm sure, in the way they process stuff and the way
absolutely. Oh,
sure. Candace will come back and be like, we have AI.
Oh, yeah, exactly. No,
straight up.
Yeah, think seriously. About that.
And so, you know, I'm just saying to women out there who feel like I got to keep working because I'm not about to depend on.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely takes a lot of trust. So you better know who it is that you're trusting. which goes back to
somebody with your body,
which means right. It goes back to who you're choosing.
And that's why I said it at the beginning.
I mean, that again, I definitely put a lot of trust in Jemal and in our relationship, but not just that. I also put trust in God. God first. Yeah. And at the end of the day, God got to have me. So God got to have me. Yeah. God got to keep me. God got to have him and God got to keep him. I can't keep him. God got to keep him.
Wait a minute now.
Well, at the end of the day, there's choices that need to be made. But as a wife, I had no problem going into our marriage fully trusting him and fully trusting him to lead us. And even now, like, so if something comes up, Jemal has a great track record as far as decision making and the position that he's put our family in. So I don't have a problem trusting him. We don't have those types of issues. Even when we were when I was working and he was working and we were about to get married, I used to give him half my paycheck, you know, because here it is. He's like, okay, well, this is what we're working towards. And and we're going to save up X amount of dollars. And I'm going to put this money towards a building and we're going to pay for our wedding. So from the very beginning, we were a team and we trusted each other.
Okay, I got, well, you want to answer that too, or are you good?
No, Camille hit the nail on the head at the end of the day. It comes down to, I trust you. You've got a great track record and I trust God. So for me, even when we were first getting married, people were asking me, you're so young. He's so much, he's, you know, a few years older than you. You trust that he's still not out here doing all this other stuff. And I'm like,
who said that?
Some co-workers at GE.
20 years later, see, like, what?
No, I didn't hear that.
And they're still working there.
No, no, but I'm just saying that people be in your head. People have opinions about what
family,
you got.
Everybody.
And I had to be like, you know what? I do trust. I trust him 100%. But to Camille's point, I trust God as well. So I'm good. Like, whatever happens, whatever life throws at us, we have
it. And them people
just
got opinions. So, they speak it from there.
Right.
Like, so everything happened to them from their point of view.
So I got another question, and this is in the same lines, but different. Again, I'm just trying to go through all the
I didn't listen to the podcast, comments. So I don't know the context of our questions.
But did you ever feel like, maybe, okay, I'm not sure what my value or my worth is now because I'm not working? Like, so much of who you were was tied to that.
No,
so you said never.
No,
I just did never.
She said never.
She said never.
That was easy.
No, yeah,
okay.
No,
Camille, go ahead.
No, because my value was never tied to a job or a position, a title. I mean, even now, I'm totally okay with being Jamal's wife and being those king kids' mom. I'm totally okay with that. I embrace that. I'm good. So no, I didn't.
Where do you think that comes from, though? Like, where do you think that confidence in knowing who you are and being okay with whatever y'all think I am? Because there are some people who, like, I'm somebody too. You know how it goes. Like, somebody might say, oh, that's Jamal's wife. Jamal's wife, I have a name. You know, just
of course I've got a name.
I'm sorry. I asked it wrong. I was just saying, to your point, to not have to be, like, presenting as this big, like, oh, I'm me too. Like, you know, you're fine with being like, this is our family unit. This is how we rock. This is the position I play, and I'm good.
I think because we are whole, healthy individuals. I think that's what it is for me. I'm whole. I'm healthy. I don't need a certain designer. I don't need a certain title. I don't need to be in the forefront. I'm totally okay with being on. I don't know what y'all about to pause or anything like that. I'm totally okay with that. Jemal has always uplifted me and inspired me, and he's always let me know how he feels about me, not just in words but in actions. So for me, I'm good.
Yeah. So I think for me, it goes back to when you were asking about how was it when I left GE? So it was great from that perspective, but it was hard because a big significant part of my life for so long. And so when I came home, it was actually the opposite. Like, I lost, like, okay, what is my, you're like at work, as I was rising the ladders, I mean, I went from high school, college, career, all like top of my class, valedictorian, graduated from Michigan State, business class, high honors, corporate ladder flying up. And it's like, all of a sudden it all stops. So for me, it was like,
that's why it's so weird when she came into my, you want some eggs?
Right. So for me, and then, I think the harder part, it goes back to vision. What Jemal was talking about was CJ was, we were both going, I was going up corporate. I was supporting where we were all heading, but he would have all these plans and I wouldn't know about them because I was at work. So you got all these plans. So when I came home, I'm not at work no more. I want to know what the plans are. I want to get involved. Like, we had like a marriage issue, and to the point, to CJ's point, it wasn't a marriage issue. It was a Candace trying to figure out her new identity issue. Yep. Mm. That I had to go by myself and work through to reestablish, to get to where Camille is of, hey, I'm good. I don't need all these. Because when you have people telling you, you're amazing, this, like, we want to promote you, we want to do this, you got people telling you that all day long, you go home and it's like, what's going on here? Like, you're not getting any of that feedback. And so for me, that's something that I had to work to get to where Camille is just taking that time with God and saying, hey, I don't have to have any title. I don't even have to have the title of wife. I don't even have the title to have a mom. I don't have to have the title of any of these things. And I'm incredible. You see what I'm saying? And I'm still her. You know what I mean? But it took a while to get there. Yeah. But I'm so happy that I was afforded the opportunity to be there. Like, hey, I don't need anything.
It was such a blessing for me, though, because she used to come home. Imagine, y'all heard her. She leave at 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, come home at 7. She would be talking to me and the kids like we was at GE. I'm dead serious. Like, you know, she just like going, 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 going. So me and the kids be at the crib just chilling, watching the show or something. She come in, did they eat? I'm like, I used to be like, yo.
Turn the GE
go
off.
Back outside. This is home.
Right.
Come back through the door and this is home. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, when you finally, you know, retired and were able to release, I think we start getting more of a true version of who you are, right?
Right, like absolutely.
What you actually, you know, do and how much you could bring to the table. Mm-hmm. I just got a few more questions. Love, we smooth, Blake? I got a few more questions. I know we've been going for a while, and this is definitely a two-parter at this point. listen, I don't know when I'm going to get y'all both back on the pod, so all I'm taking full advantage. Sorry, I know anybody ate and used the bathroom and all of that. But, now that we're here, right? And we're here, we are here, like, and we enjoying life. Two questions, sorry. How have y'all, everyone here, I think when I look at marriages that ended, there was always like one person or maybe even both had this midlife crisis, right? You always hear this. And I want to talk, I'm talking to grown folk now, like y'all listen to this pod. Shout out to y'all if y'all younger and all of that, but we know most of the people who follow this pod are around our age, 40s, whatever. How have y'all, we'll start with y'all, y'all a tad bit older than us, but like how have you avoided that midlife crisis? Because we see so many people, whether it be the man or the woman, who they have this moment where they just turn into somebody else, right? And that's how that divorce ends up happening. How have y'all avoided that?
Yeah, it goes back to the five pillars. And Camille can tell you, you know, it's great having her on here because, you know, I talk about things and then it seems like, oh, he just came up with this. I didn't have a name for the five pillars, but how long have you ever known me not to work out every day?
Never.
I've been doing this forever. But at the time, this is why I hate beginnings, because she'd been with me since I was about 16 years old. I had a six pack. I woke up. I was born with a six pack. You know, I had rips. I was all of that, but I was still working out. I wasn't working out so I can get more of a six pack at 16. I was working out so when I got 26, I would still have that six pack.
Yeah.
And then when I was 26, I worked out. So at 36, I would still have it. At 36, I did it. So 46. So I'm always doing that to set up the next version of myself. And so even in our marriage, we do certain things where it's setting us up for the next level in our life. And I think that's how, what's the word you use?
Midlife crisis?
Yeah, midlife crisis. So that's how you...
You don't even know what it is.
That's how, exactly.
Now, we talk, me and Mar talk
about that's how, but you see, a lot of times people have this midlife crisis because they are not where they want to be.
Yeah.
They haven't built any equity. So they're not happy with their bodies. So now all of a sudden they're doing some crazy stuff to try to make themselves feel good because they don't like the way they look in their body no more. They're not happy with their finances. So then all of a sudden they got to rush and do things, or they don't even do things to fix it. They just take it out on their spouse. And then they say, I'm not happy with myself because of you.
I would be so much farther along.
If I was a better wife, then maybe I could be further along in my finances. If you was a better wife, if you did cook food for me the right way, and then I could eat healthy.
I don't like all this aggression.
I don't like it.
Hey, let's flip that up for the promo of the pod and make it look like Maul was really saying that to Camille.
Oh, that's going to go by.
Oh, yeah, to go
then,
viral.
Then if you cooked a healthy food for me, then I didn't want to pick up all this weight. And so this one, as opposed to taking accountability and saying at a younger age, like, yo, if I don't make a change myself, then therefore we're going to be in this predicament later on in life. And so I think that that's what goes back to the beginning of the pod when I was talking about you got to go into the future.
Yeah.
In everything, you got to go faith-wise. Literally, I knew that no matter how much I loved Camille, no matter how much she loved me, oh, Jemal, you know, man, I can't wait till we get married. I got letters, Camille saying all this. I'm saying all of that to her. If we didn't have God in our life, if we didn't have some type of foundation, I knew that it wouldn't work eventually. Yeah. That honeymoon phase is going to wear off. And when it wears off, what foundation do you have? What principles do you have? What do you have? And so I think that most people that get divorced, ironically, is because of that midlife crisis, something that they're not happy with. You know, whether it's themselves, whether it's the position, the stress. You thought that this person, and what happens with a midlife crisis is that you thought that everybody in the beginning got this fantasy of how they believe their life going to be. You know, young ladies grow up like, oh, Prince Charles is going to come and take me away, and we're just going to live happily ever after. And then when Prince Charles, at the age of 40, got a dead bod, he got that belly sitting out. And he
ain't, careful.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And he not looking like what you thought. Now it's like, oh, you know, all right, if he looking like this at 40, he ain't about to just all of a sudden get a six-pack by age 50. You start seeing, if he ain't making money, when they say your 40s is the highest earning income, I believe 40s and 50s, if he ain't making money right now at this age, he talking about retiring, your salary going to get cut. So you start seeing everything like, well, look, I done got to the highest point with him or with her, and it ain't looking like what I dreamed of or what I envisioned. So now it's like, oh, I'm not happy no more. So then you jump ship. You say, oh, I need to leave now. I'm having a midlife crisis. And I just believe that that's all set up from not preparing.
And at the same time, I think this age is set up to take on the most stress, right? Because you think about it, like when you're in your 20s, you ain't really got no kids like that, or you do got kids and they super young. Your parents are still super young. Now you talk about like you kind of got to, you like looking out for your people, your parents too, making sure they straight, and then you making sure your kids straight. So you're kind of like, what they call it, like the sandwich generation, where it's like, yo, you kind of like, it's you. You know what I'm saying? Like, think about even like the health challenges Pops had. You know
right,
what I'm
saying?
Right,
but this is a stressful, this age is, and
well, that's what I'm pointing to. Yeah. Is like, I think that those things are so important because you're also dealing with more at this age. You know
but
what I'm saying?
That's why you gotta know God before. The storm
comes. Before the storm comes. Yeah.
You got to know God before you see that when you start, your wife started finishing the sentence. You see
come that? On, that's I heard
the
it.
The two shall become one.
Yeah, I heard it.
But you got to know God before you run into any, before your parents start getting sick. But like I told y'all before, there's no secret in my book and everything. I talk about my dad. I talk about how he's Superman for me. Like my father been in my life, you know, my whole life, you know, and even in this moment, Father's Day was just, the other day. Even in this moment, I can still sit back and say, man, thank you, God.
Mm-hmm.
Even in this, I could find the God in everything.
Mm-hmm.
In everything, I could find the God in everything. And I can sit back and I can still give encouragement. I can still, speak from a place of gratitude. But that didn't just happen today. that's built up over time. Knowing scripture every day for how long?
I don't know.
Every day for probably over 15 years. I send out one scripture to every family member and some of my friends. I send out one scripture to meditate on, to memorize. I didn't do that so when times are good, I'm like, no, I did it so when times come like this, I know that rest, everything is coming together. You know, all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and is called by his purpose. I these words come to me as I'm going through it financially. I know that, look, at the times, there's been times Camille and I, daycare center was making in the high six figures a month. Talking about we had so much money, we didn't know what to do with it. I started just buying properties every month. I was just buying the houses. Didn't know, because it was too much to put in the bank. I just would buy houses every month. Just buy houses, period, building. Camille didn't even care. She didn't ask me how many properties. She just was like, yo, I said, look, some of this money needs to go into a building or something. So but it was not for the time when we had a lot of money. It was so that, because nothing lasts forever. So it was at the times when, you know, when a daycare maybe is going to struggle, COVID, anything.
Yeah.
We got the money and something else that would be producing. And so it's like, you have to help yourself out.
We're all going to find a way to turn any question back into investing.
But everything, the Bible talks about it, you know? Ecclesiastes 6:11, work your work in the morning, in the evening, let not your hands be idle.
Mm-hmm. Either you believe the word or you don't.
Because you don't know which will work, whether it's this or that, or whether they all do equally well. Yeah. So literally, I've learned how to, in every situation, to be content, you know, whether good or bad. Scripture just comes... It comes to me, right? Because I'm so immersed in it. Mm-hmm. And it allows us to life is already hard on its own. But when you able to help yourself out, I'm able to help. When me and my wife are able to set ourselves up where it helps us out, we don't know what's going to come in the future. But we do know, like our life possibly could have been hard if she would have been working a 9-to-5, because we wouldn't have had... You know, so we wouldn't have started the daycare centers without Camille. Like, I wouldn't have done it. It wouldn't even have happened. Who knows? I might have not even bought as much real estate as I have right now without Camille, because I wouldn't have had so much freedom to be able to just go to the properties and me and Felipe, me and Uncle Milton. And we literally, I used to spend 10 hours a day doing Home Depot properties. I never had to worry about my household because she was able to take care of it. So we have invested in the future us, which has now averted any kind of midlife crises that we're going through. We love our 40s. We in bliss right now because we set ourselves up.
Camille, you want to follow that or are you good?
Oh, no, I'm good. Okay. I totally agree with what he's saying.
Anything to add? Are you good? And we got one more question here and we're getting out of here.
I'm going to let you answer the next question. I'm not saying that.
No. You need to answer. This is a question for everybody.
All right.
We'll start with Maul since he just finished a great little diatribe there. What do you appreciate most about Camille in 2024?
It's easy, bro. Her heart. Camille got a heart of gold is too, that's too cheap. She got a heart of vibranium.
That's what I was going to say.
She got a heart of vibranium. Literally, Camille and God knew when he was making her what I needed. At times, I can be aggressive. Not aggressive in my hands, of course.
You ain't never slapped it with a credit card.
I ain't never slapped it.
You soft, dog.
You gotta smack her up every now and then. My daddy was a cop. My mama was a cop. But she had her spirit is perfect for mine because her spirit calms me down. Literally, after dealing with you jokers, the podcast and speaking and traveling the world and pouring into so many people, I can just literally, no matter how much, I do so much. Still real estate, I'm hands-on, still speaking, coaching, all this other stuff we do. And then I can just come on the couch and just lay my head on her shoulder. And she rubbed my head and I just fall right to sleep. It's still like, that's that, even, you know, that's that, even times when me and C used to be on the road and he would know after I speak, I'd just be jacked up. Like, it's something
don't
about
act like I never.
No, you know, you never. You never. You never.
Put you to sleep a couple times, too.
Not at all. Nigga, matter of fact, I used to wait.
You and E.
I used to wait till you go to sleep first because I used to see you walking around in your tidy whities. And I'm like, come hey, on. Man, just do.
Hey, man.
But
you got to have good support.
But, you know, I will say, like, Camille definitely has become my peace. And I never understood that before until my man and the man said, man, I need you to be my peace. Like, she has really become my peace. I don't fight with her. That's the place that I need to rest. Like I said, her love for God exceeds all understanding. her mother's love for God, her grandmother, she come from a long line of godly women. I'm sure, you know, they say the prayers of the righteous availeth much. I do believe that one of the reasons that I'm even having this blessing over my life is definitely because of the prayers of not just my wife, but the prayers of her mother and the prayers of her grandmother. I still remember back when I was 21 years old, matter of fact, to this day, almost on my birthday, 21st birthday, had surgery, and her grandmother, you know, literally came in the house. I was after surgery, went home. Her grandma came in the house and she literally put some oil on me and literally just put her hands on me and was like praying over me until I fell asleep. Like literally, and it might've took about 15, 20 minutes, because I was like, yo, this is weird. You know, she touching me and rubbing me and all this. I was like, yeah, grandma.
I see where Camille got
it. Like, yo. But she was praying over me. And literally, I remember I didn't feel no pain. And she was like speaking a word to me. She was talking in tongues and things like that. But you can just see the anointing that's over her family, that's over her. And yeah, I literally give all the thanks in the world, not to me, because I'm the recipient. This 46-year-old Jemal is the recipient of what that 16, 17, 18-year-old Jemal had the heart to do. It wasn't popular to be with, you know, one girl, to be, you know, man, why you in a serious relationship? I had all kind of people like, yo, you Division I football. You, man, Omega Psi Phi. Man, you captain of the football team, bro. Like, you... And it was just like, yo, I see something in her. Like, I see something that my future needs, that our future needs. And so when it comes to being a mother, hands down, I'm talking about me. I'm me. You know, I tell my kids, man, y'all need to do it. You need to do it. Like, do this, do that. And, you know, well, daddy, why? Because you're supposed to, you know, that type of stuff. Camille still, like, takes time, breaks everything down. So that's the one thing is so many things that I love about
her. That's the one thing.
That's the one thing.
Brother gave 20 minutes. But I go first.
I'm just saying, you know what I'm saying? I said
the one thing.
Bro, you trying to put 30 years into one.
I said the two. That's why I said 2024.
Right. I heard that.
I knew, but yeah. Hey, bro, you don't need to apologize for the love you got for your
I'm just saying. That's like, beautiful. This was perfect.
Beautiful. What's the one thing you...
Camille gonna follow
Same
the rules.
I will follow the rules. I will follow the rules.
Jemal. And again, I really did want to know the one thing, because it's like, again, I'm teasing, but like, we're here now. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're about to embark on this pilgrimage to Egypt right quick. You know what I'm saying? Like, we do have, you know, our kids in the place we want them to be, and they're like, life is good. And it's like, okay, like, you still have that appreciation for your spouse, and like, what is it? We know all of the things from back then that kind of made the foundation. Like, what is it in 2024 where you be like, man?
For me, it will definitely be his vision. Even from in the past, it's his past vision that has gotten us to this point. And it's like, as the days go by and certain things happen, it becomes even clearer that the vision was so necessary, even though there were times that maybe I didn't understand it. Some things may have been uncomfortable. I may not have wanted to sacrifice in certain ways. But Jemal told me years ago, probably early 2000s, we working towards something, you know, and he was able to paint that vision for me. And now we're living in the vision and we're traveling in the vision. Our children are blessed because of the vision. We're surrounded by you all because of the vision. He's impacting people around the world because of the vision. And now I see like, you know, some of the couples or the people that you, you know, you see who's having issues, a lot of it is because there was a lack of vision. Because if there was a clear vision for their family or for their children, your vision, it'll give you energy to keep going. Mm. Because it's like, I see the bigger picture. So regardless if we disagree about something or this isn't necessarily working right, the vision is clear. So it's going to give me energy to keep on going, to keep on trying, to keep waking up, to keep going after this. The vision is going to let me know, like, what I should do, what I shouldn't do. Like, just GPS, like road signs.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I'm seeing it. And because of the vision, we're able to send our kids to the schools that we're able to send them to. Mm. We live an amazing life. So at the end of the day, for me, it's the vision. And that's what I appreciate the most in 2024. Because right now I'm seeing families fall apart. I'm seeing kids not be able to go to college. I'm seeing, you see so much devastation and so much trauma. But, and if it not been for God and if it not been for you, the same thing could have happened to our family. And I know that God didn't bless me with that. Mm-hmm. God blessed me to support the visionary. And I'm totally okay with that. I deal a lot more in the day-to-day, you know, and I just want to support the vision. So for me, that's what I appreciate the most in 2024, the vision.
That's a perfect.
All right, boo.
I don't have one thing. You have to tell me. No, but you have to tell me which one is, because I don't know which one is the driving force, if that makes sense, of what I'm about to say. No, for you. I know. But for me, this is so I look at it for you in 2024, the one thing or the things that I love the most about is your balance, your leadership, your wholeness. They're all together. I don't know what word encompass them all, but it's like the way that you lead with clarity, with conviction, and it makes everybody around you fall in line in a peaceful way. Like, it's not stressful. It's an ease about it. And I think that goes to your wholeness. You're so whole in who you are and who God has called you to be, that it's infectious. You light that fire in anyone who has the privilege to be around you. So what did I say? Wholeness, your leadership, and balance. I think our life is absolutely insane in a good way, right? And there's so many things that are being thrown at us constantly, problems that you have to solve. But somehow you're able to just stay as steady as a rock. Like, no, you don't waver back and forth. We can have up things go well, things go bad. You're good, and you keep us good. You keep me good. So those are the things. I don't know if that's
what
that's real. Man, for me, it would definitely be your faith. My wife is just a savage. Like, it don't matter what's going on in the world. It don't matter what's going on at home. She gonna wake up and keep our family covered. Like, she is, for her age, Candace got the spirit of like an 85-year-old prayer warrior. Like, for real. And always has.
Right, absolutely.
And like, you know, I finally just bought her a Remarkable. You know what that is? Like a little pad.
Electronic journal.
But like, I finally saw it, and it's like, you could write like almost like it's paper. Like, for real. It's not like writing on an iPad or something like that. But I had to write it because she just has so many, like, notebooks full and full and full. She'll just get up in the morning and write to God and write what's going on. And, like, I don't know if I've ever told you, like, how much, like, I appreciate that. Like, me, I'm talking about, we knocked out to the world. She will go in. If I can't find her in the house, I'll be like, oh, she's in the closet. And I'll walk past and peek in. She will be in the closet. 5:30 in the morning with one light on in the whole house and just writing for an hour and just praying and like really like not for to be seen or not for me or like all of us pray together, but just her own relationship with God has kept us covered so much throughout the years. And the strength that you have from where you came from and how you continue to just be a rock star for our family, and like, for real, don't let nothing like hinder your spirit. Like, it's crazy. Like, again, I told E and Candace, I'm like, having the two of y'all around praying all day, it's like, it makes you want to get closer to God. So when I see my wife, you know, going in like that, you know, it's just like, it makes you want to dig deeper in your own faith. And there's no doubt in my mind that we are where we are, because although I'm the man of the house and I keep us safe and do everything, my wife is one of them prayer warriors where, like, when people call me and they going through it, I'd be like, yeah, hold on. Like, her and God, they got, like, something that's unmatched. And yeah. So I would say your relationship with God in 2024 is on such a different level. And I told somebody the other day, and I think, I don't remember where I was when I said, we were out to dinner that night when I said it. I'm being real with y'all, like, the selfish part of me wants to keep my wife for me.
Yeah.
But I already know that God's got some crazy things planned for her, because women specifically need your ministering. Like, they need to hear you. And for a while I've been like, okay, maybe that's enough to scratch the itch that she just runs the church and kind of gets her spiritual fulfillment from that. And God been telling me lately, like, you about to give up some time with your wife here shortly, because she's about to be on the road. I've already seen it, like, speaking, traveling, and giving the word to women who need it, young women who need it, especially, like, who feel a sense of despair because they're coming from the type of environment that you came from. And your story is bigger than anything else. And so I'm prepared and 2024 and beyond to share the world with you. I shared GE with you, and I was kind of selfish when I got
I
you back.
I need to get prepared.
But now it's time, and I know the problem is I'm the one who knows how to facilitate that. So it's almost like I'm walking myself off the plank. I'm joking, but I know what that's going to mean for us, and it's only going to make us stronger because God's going to double, fold what, you know, whatever we put out. But
yeah.
I am ready to start sharing your gift with everybody else. And
we got it on record.
2024.
Candace.
I know.
Candace.
I said it the other day.
We got it on record. We've been vibing for 3 hours.
Got it on record.
I don't know. Yeah.
So, anyway, man, I love all three of y'all. I appreciate y'all.
Yeah. You know what's so crazy, though? You know what's so crazy? This is the resultant evidence of what I prayed for.
Come on.
Years ago, bro. This is it. Camille could tell you. Before we even knew y'all.
We're going to find out Maul had a little journal. He was like, yeah, we all on the podcast together. And Camille talking about.
I just got to go.
I wrote this. Years ago, I wrote this. I was 5.
It's going to be a picture of me right now.
Yeah.
But no, just to be able to, real talk, just to be able to travel.
100%.
Yeah.
It came a point where Camille and I would just start traveling alone because nobody could keep up. It was hard. Let's just say that. If people wasn't in a position, well, not just financially, maybe they had to work and they couldn't take off work. Or just, you know, or if they did, they really wasn't happy with the person they were with.
Yeah,
it was just different levels. And so to be able to, man, to be with, you know, someone like this, you know, you all, and to be able to share into, you know, like for me, I'm not big on holidays. I'm not big on Easter, Christmas, Thanksgiving, all of that. But you know, my birthday is a national treasure.
Yep.
That right there is like, yo, that's the,
we're gonna be at the pyramid.
Y'all all know.
Yes.
And so.
Happy birthday, by the way.
Happy birthday.
Another trip around the sun.
Yeah, absolutely.
Happy birthday. And y'all, first of all, y'all go subscribe to the Patreon. Y'all getting all of this stuff. You know what I'm saying? Show us some love. Go to the Patreon, S2S Podcast. Also, I usually don't say this, but if y'all know, y'all listen to these last, this is 2 episodes now, send it to some married couples. Send it to some people who about to get married. Send it to some people who thinking about getting married. Send it to the single people so they know how to be when you get married. But I don't say this lightly. Like, we always said, like, yo, we look up to y'all. And we got E and Didi. Yes. You know, we got Chuck and Money. We got people in our lives who we've looked
marriages.
Up to. And you know, y'all have come in our lives, man, and just watching, even when we first met y'all and we wasn't like all the way locked in, it was like, y'all would be like, oh yeah, we going on a cruise, we going here, we going there. And we used to be like, dang, like, you know, we'll wait for like a work trip or something, but y'all inspired us to
lock in
more. So, you know what I'm saying? We appreciate y'all for that. And thank Camille, thank you especially because I know you're a little bit outside of your comfort zone coming on the pod, but
thanks for having
I appreciate
me.
You. Right. And Camille is going to start a marriage conference.
Yes.
That's
coaching with Camille.
Yeah, coaching with Camille. I prophesize over my wife.
One on one. But that's what she said. One on one.
Coaching with Camille and Candace.
It's about $25,000 a
session. Yeah. So, oh, that's nice. Coaching with Camille and Candace.com.
Thank y'all for paying attention. Thank y'all for listening. We love y'all. We out of here. We'll see you next week.
Let's go.
I want you to focus on here right now. Don't you worry about when you get home. You make this, you concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity with all your might, with all your soul, with all your heart.
Thank you so much for rocking with us as always, right? We don't take it lightly, guys. And we hope that we've provided transformation and not just information. We want you to become the best version of yourself, right? Make sure you check out the show notes to access all the important links and get your product discounts. Now, one favor we're asking of you, do us this favor. Make sure you subscribe and leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. We want to know your feedback and how we can serve you better. And if there's anyone that you think could benefit from listening to this show, please, I'm begging you, please share it with them. And remember, as E always says, if you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful.